This is the larger feed ink ball from Noodlers. Noodlers teardrop clip. Noodlers imprinted band. It's flush with the edge. It's to protect it from pressure. This is a handmade ebonite tip. And I've heard with the smaller model, people have occasionally had dryouts. This one I've tried to kill, and it's been on a writing machine repeatedly to see when it will wear out. This is Noodler's Black. Earlier this pen was writing with Eel Blue and Eel Turquoise. I've found that the ability to continue on the writing machine is improved. This one is longer lasting than most. I don't know why. There is some variability. I believe it's dependent upon the angle. If the angle is straight up and down, it seems to wear out faster. If the angle is too far to the edge, it also wears out faster. But if it's just like this, right at that sweet spot that's at the wettest, it's basically writing like a stylographic. And that is at the point where there is the least resistance, and you'll notice the pen is writing at its smoothest at that angle. And with the Eel inks, it's lasted to the equivalent of basically not being able to get the thing to wear out. With some other inks, I've been able to get the writing machine to wear it out. But even with those, even using some pretty tough 19th century style inks, it doesn't wear out that fast. What has happened, if people stop using it and it dries out, there are people that will report, well, it clogged and I've replaced it, or I don't trust it switching to a different ink and I've replaced it. You just take tweezers, any tweezers, the kind you'd find at a pharmacy for 80 cents, and grip it firmly, twist, and pull it out. Take this felt, put it under a faucet, a running faucet, and rinse it off. If you want to increase the flow to the ball, pull out the felt and split it in half lengthwise, and that will increase your flow if you want a darker line. Pull out the felt from the ball housing and put it under a pulsating faucet where you've shut the faucet almost completely and there is a small pulsating stream of water and direct it into the opening. And you will have a cleaned up a ball housing, and your dry out should be no more. That works most of the time, and you should thus be able to make it last a considerable length of time. And again, the Eel Blue, the Eel Turquoise, Eel Green, they, in testing, under the worst circumstances, at the worst angles, they've lasted longer than the other inks. But that's more or less what those inks were designed to do anyway. Now this is a brush pen. It can write on a single hair to about 4 or 5. Towards being quite thick. Now, this particular model that has this band here in both the roller and the brush pen, I've had quite a long time to think about fountain pens and better ideas about design. I keep coming into my head. The section and the filler are going to be changed. This model already has its days numbered. It's pretty much being introduced as a limited edition, mainly because this larger clutchless model is going to be replaced with another model that has a faster and less costly repair rate. The model replacing it, if you read the instructions first on how to replace the seal, you should be able to do so in less than a minute, and you should be able to do so with a total cost of about 40 cents, which if you look at piston fillers and the cost of replacing seals, 40 cents is pretty good. And by 40 cents, I mean buying it from a local retailer, a local hardware store. You don't have to spend on postage to get it from afar. Assuming you have access to an Ace Hardware, a Lowe's, a Home Depot, or your local hardware store. And that is why this pen's days are numbered. It's a handful going out of both of these, and then they will be replaced in as soon as possible. If they sell out, my apologies, but these won't be reissued in this particular design. I always thought it would have been nice had, say, Parker, for instance, told us about the vacuum filler. We're only going to issue this for a brief time, and then it'll become the Parker Vacuumatic, or the Integral Parker 61. We're only going to issue it for a brief time, and then it's just a prototype and it's gone. Well, this is hopefully my act of courtesy to anybody who might be collecting these later on, if that ever happens. This one's going to be short and sweet and no longer produced very, very quickly. These handmade ebonite feeds, I just also wanted to point out, if you look through patents and patent history, a lot of these don't show up. They were made in the latter part of the 1800s. They were among the earliest fountain pens. There are examples that I've restored over the years, made in Japan in particular, that existed fairly early on in the 20th century as well. These were used by some fairly famous people, including Cixi, the Empress Dowager of China, as well as her son Puyi, the father of Hirohito, yet as well as Sun Yat-sen, and other notables. There is even a photo, I was notified, of Mao Zedong and Zhou Enlai using a piston-filled brush pen. That, of course, would be much later, and I don't know where they got them, because it was mostly Aerometrics issued there. But the earlier versions were actually eyedropper fillers. And it's quite a treat to find a historic photo and recognize that it's not a Western fountain pen, it's a brush pen from the East. And that ebonite was enabling these tips to be automatically fed continuously so far back that it rivals the time date of the first patents issued for the nibbed pens by Duncan MacKinnon, A.T. Cross, Ellie Waterman, etc. And my last comment on that, there's a photo out there where Hirohito's dad had a brush pen. Some of you might not know it about him. he was asked to give a speech before the diet, and they sort of kept him out of the public eye after the speech because he took the speech, rolled it up, and used it as a telescope to view all of the members of the diet. And he didn't say anything, and apparently just left the podium after doing that. It would have been worthwhile to be a fly on the wall in that particular day. It's got a bigger chamber than the standard size. Holding more ink. It's basically a 19 late 40s, mid 50s clip, sort of the Adenauer era piston filler. It has an air vent in the back. When the piston draws back, the air can easily be expelled. It doesn't cause any pressure, and it accepts, to start with, initially, two threaded units that write as an ink ball and as a brush pen. You'll note here it has a rounded band that protects the cap lip. The ball clip, this classic teardrop clip, has good spring in its structure for thick fabrics, but also due to the shape, it's not going to catch on any fine dress shirt. The ink supply is visuated. When it starts to get down here, if you notice any expansion due to the heat of your hand expanding the air in the chamber, you'll see it, and you'll know that it's time to fill the pen to avoid further expansion. Here I have a handmade ebonite brush feed. It has a spiral feed to it. If you note here, the air ink interchange is not through the complete spiral. There's an air vent here, about four lines up. And this is very similar to automated feeds for stylos. Many of the brush pens available now, some that fill with cartridges have an automatic feed, but many of the piston fillers don't. There's one being made in China at the moment that you have to manually turn the piston when the brush gets dry. There are others you have to squeeze the side of the barrel when the brush gets dry. This will automatically feed. It automatically has an air ink interchange, just like a classic fountain pen, very similar to the handmade ebonite brush pens of 100 years ago that one would see in Japan and in China. Some of you back channel saw a mention of a brush pen in an earlier video, and it asked if Noodlers would be offering more affordable sable and some of the traditional animal hair brushes. I'm not a member of PETA, and I'm not exactly an animal rights activist. I'll occasionally have a steak, and not all of my fish are catch and release. If I manage to get away from this business and go fishing at all. But I do think there's a practical way to run an industry, and that the fur industry on the far side of the Pacific has a lot wanting. I also don't like the fact that the organic furs, they rot, they develop molds. There are certain inks that I've stored with them. I've been reading that they've had mold issues with animal hair in brush pens. So the decision has been made that noodlers will, under no circumstances, ever issue an animal hair brush pen. This is nylon. It's fine, if not finer, than what they advertise for the animal hairs. Its action upon the page, I view it as highly desirable for writing. It lasts longer. It doesn't have any issues. And best of all, with this particular feed, this is one without the brush, you'll note it's a lot narrower than the base brush. This feed is hand cut inside for an automatic taper. You cut this at the base into even thirds, and you remove the corners, and you put a small amount of rubber cement on the lip corner, and you push it in here. When this brush wears out, you take the end of a paper clip or the like, you unscrew this feed from the section, and you poke it out. Then you replace it. There's enough out of these replacements that you can have 6 brushes for $1. That's full retail from your noodler's dealer. And to demonstrate, this one, this is cut as a third. If you cut it as a half, the brush will come out shorter, and you won't have to screw it in as far into the barrel. If the brush is long, you'll have more detail in terms of the responsiveness of the brush. But so that it doesn't hit the end of the inner cap, it should be screwed into the barrel further. Those details are in the instructions with the pens, but you'll note it's about a third, and the edges have been cut off. This rubber cement. Dip it into a little bit of water. This enables it to be, holds it together. Nice point. On the outer edge, tiny dab. Get it down on the brush side. There. Perfect. Insert it into the ebonite feed. This is the classic way it was done 100 years ago. These actually functioned as early as the 1890s. They became more common after 1910. This is, of course, modern. You use a dowel, end of a Q-tip, something like that. Let it dry. Initial installation of these, this is a brand new pen. The threads form on the first turn. It's likely you will not you will not encounter that. Because once the threads form, it becomes increasingly easy to screw in and screw out these brush pens. For a brush about this size, you just want to see the back of the feed through the clear chamber. If the brush were longer, like this, you would simply screw the brush in deeper until you'd see the point come out, maybe about 2 millimeters deeper into the chamber. And this will bring the point back away from the inner cap. Easy and quick way to tell. Now, the inner cap has, it's seated. Put your thumb right where the cap stopped. And note that the top of this cap at this end is approximately 0.5 millimeter thick. You see, it fits. If it were here, it wouldn't be fitting. It would be pushing at the end. You don't want to do that to your brush, but here it fits. It was noted that virtually none of the brush pens, including, disposables are disposable. You pay $3 or so, and it gets thrown out once it runs out of a single filling of ink. I find that remarkably wasteful. And these refill and refill and refill. And instead of throwing out the mechanism, as a couple of the ones made in China, you just throw out the mechanism once it wears out. That being the brush wears out. The brush is going to wear out first. All of these other parts are going to last a lot longer. This ebonite feed for a brush, if it's well cared for, in theory it could make it 100 years. There's no reason to waste any of this. So these brushes, pop them out, cut them in a third or in a half, depending upon your preference of how thick you want the brush to be. As you use them, you quickly find out what your preference is, whether it's for a thick or a thin elongated brush or a short brush. And this is the equivalent of 6 brushes for a dollar, cut into thirds. You get 2 of these for a dollar, and 3 of them, 3 from each brush, will enable you to fit into the ebonite feed. The raw brush, in this form, will not fit. It literally, the diameter is so big that the brush, when it's put in, it only goes to about here. It absolutely has to be cut in some form to get it to slide down and to form the center of the feed. Now this is a brush pen that's filled with Newler's Black. I've used these in the past only because I was restoring a pen for a Japanese customer. Or I was intrigued by the vintage Japanese brush pens. Happened to deal with Japan before I dealt with China. I was dealing with Japan in the late 80s. And it's their brush pens that I was most familiar with. This design combines American stylo ideas with Japanese brush ideas, and the Chinese brush structure, of course, which the Japanese borrowed even earlier. They tend to write almost perpendicular in Japan and in China, and you want this razor tight formation and this extraordinarily sharp point. And by doing so, it takes skill, but if you have control, You can make a very fine line, literally the width of two hairs. You just need two hairs to feed it to the page. With less control and discipline, it can get quite wide. Say, calligraphy type lines. But as I've seen it, there are people who are able to fill in tiny crossword puzzles with these pens in Beijing and Shanghai and Tokyo, and they do so with amazing discipline. And I have not yet gotten to that stage. I barely know how to write manenhitsu. But nevertheless, they're fun. The continuous feeding, it works. It will keep going as the day is long. You don't have to push the sides, you don't have to operate a pump, you don't have to do anything like that. And the brush lasts quite a long time. And when it finally goes, unlike every other brush manufacturer out there, brush pen manufacturer out there, this handmade ebonite feed will enable you to utilize quite an affordable unit for brush replacements. No need for, I've seen replacement brushes ranging anywhere from on the low end with wide fibers, wider fibers than this. This is easily rivals the Sable in terms of the fineness of each individual strand of fiber. So another reason I do not consider the animal fur to be pertinent. I get given the advance of the synthetics, there is no reason for any of that. Some people say, well, farming them, you're promoting the species. I don't think you're really promoting the species. Not what they're doing, the way they harvest and the like. Just leave them alone, particularly those Asiatic raccoons. But that's the brush, and two of these for $1 from distribution and certain retailers, it makes for 6 replacements. And as far as I know, it is the only handmade, all-natural ebonite brush feed that's available today. To get a continuous feeding ebonite brush feed, a vintage pen would cost well over $150 that operates in this fashion from the 1920s and the like. This is far more affordable. Nylon piston, very German design, although not a single part comes from Germany. Hope you like them, and I hope you like the concept, and I hope it gives you a meaningful alternative for this particular technology of ink delivery. This, in other videos I've shown it, it's one of those tiki torches, usually filled with citronella, drive away mosquitoes, makes a tiny candle flame. You can tap down this wick so that the flame will be only 0.2 millimeters or so. Very, very low flame, easy to control. A lot of people still tell me that it's difficult to get circular wick lamps for pen repair. And I'm telling you again and again, you don't have to spend $40 for a specialty lamp. You don't have to spend for some vintage style lamp at a flea market or antique store. 50 cents, I'm not kidding. You can get these off season just as the season ends for 50 cents and buy them by the dozen. And if you don't like throwing them out, you can refill them with a syringe with liquid paraffin. And they're a real deal. Now, likewise, some of you have said on the larger piston fillers, and this dates back to vintage pens, certain Pelicans and the like, where do you get the O-ring to fix a nylon piston that's been shot and is beyond widening with the lamp? This is an example of one. It's 1/4 by 1/8 by 1/16, the number 60 O-ring, and stock number 35774B. This was at Home Depot. It was less than a dollar. It's individually wrapped. Some hardware stores will sell this. This is an O-ring for a particular type of faucet. Some of them are over a dollar, others are 35 cents. But you can buy one at a time. Now, in theory, you can get them cheaper, but you're probably going to have to get them by the thousands. And this is, if you're fixing one pen, it keeps your cost down. Now, this is the larger piston mount for the Noodler's pen. And the first way to get a piston that is worn, now nylon, most of the European piston fillers use nylon. Nylon can last 20, 25 years. Active pen, 15 or so. In Asia, they've begun using neoprene and some of the rubber, usually in a disposable pen. Like there's a disposable brush pen that once the brush wears out, you throw it out, and it's actually got a piston on it, and that's a neoprene type piston. They're less costly to make, but I don't like the idea of tossing this out and replacing the unit when you can replace it far more affordably with something like this, or by altering it. Now, I'll show two examples here. This is an example where the ribbed nylon is a separate ring from the center nylon. It's a mold, and you can see that in the camera here. Now, this ribbed ring can be cut off and removed, and it forms a stump. Now, that's not very useful by itself for an O-ring. You can put an O-ring over a stump, but without an edge, like this one has, you see this edge here, this enables the O-ring to be mounted. Like so. Now, granted, the O-ring stretched over this is going to have a slightly wider diameter, but the nice thing about these O-rings is that they have a lot of give, and you can get them in the barrel with a little bit of silicone grease and they will flatten. They'll be somewhat tight, but you will have an amazingly good seal. And I prefer this method of fixing this piston because for 35 cents to a dollar and change, you can replace it. And these last a long time. These faucet O-rings are meant to last a very long time. For a plumber to go through the effort to undo your faucet and to replace this little tiny seal, and then it fails in a year, his reputation is mud. He needs that thing to last 5, 10, 15 years so that you think he's a good plumber. And these these have to have really good tolerances. Now, for a pen that doesn't have to move anywhere near as much as a faucet does every day, it's a superb application. And when it wears off, pop it off, put on a new one. It's pennies. Now, if you don't have access to O-rings and you need the pen to work right away, you simply heat the end knob after you've removed this skirt, the ribbed skirt, and flatten it with your finger, like this. And that widens it. And this actually becomes an extraordinarily strong seal. And based on tolerances and my experience with it, this seal's it's a 10-year seal at this point, after it's been adjusted this way. However, when this one fails, it's not replaceable indefinitely. This one is. Over and over and over again, you can replace this seal whenever it wears out in the future. If you start off as a 20-year-old person, you can be in retirement and still be replacing the seal in the same groove. That, in my opinion, is a better, in theory, it's a better repair than one that has an inevitable end. You want a repair that can continue. And, well, I'll give one example of it. Now, this is fresh from the store. It has that high a flame. I would generally reduce the flame. Going right below the ribbed area. See? I just removed the ribbed area, and this is what it looks like. Now, putting an O-ring over that, it isn't going to help things. So, bingo. See that? Literally can interchange the O-ring, and it's not coming off. It's seated. It's as easy as that. Now, before you even go through this, be sure this thing is completely shut, because you can put this . See, it naturally curls back in response to the heat of the flame. I don't know if you can see that. Now, you can do this to Pelicans, Mont Blancs, Omases, all sorts of pens. And you can get additional life out of a nylon seal this way. And if there is any fee for the replacement of a nylon seal, or the pen is so-called out of warranty, the Noodler's pens do not have a warranty, because I believe if you can pick up a pen for $14 to $20 and avoid any fee for a service department, it benefits you a great deal more than picking up a pen for $200, $300, $500 and it has a nice polished little warranty on it that has restrictions that basically say you don't own your pen. You can't use this type of ink, you can't do this, you can't do that. You have various restrictions, and you can only use branded products, and if you don't, the warranty is null and void. Now, did you buy the pen or you didn't? Is it yours or is it still the company's? When you buy a Noodler's pen, it's your pen, and there isn't any warranty restriction or any restriction of any kind. And to fix it, if you put an O-ring on, or you simply widen it, or you make it a stub piston with the flame. All of the above. It's up to you. It's complete freedom with the product. You truly own it. And hope this information is of use. This is the clutchless mechanism frequently. It simply turns out. If it doesn't turn out, and unscrew from the back like this, simply obstruct its forward motion further back. Just screwing it back in. And you see how the O-ring exhibits flattened sides? This is what you're looking for. That is a perfect seal. Now this is when it's just been widened. I want to show you see that seal that it forms? It's a perfect seal. And that's simply heating the nylon. Very tight. These pistons, they should close right up to here, so you're looking at approximately half the barrel in capacity. Fairly efficient for a clutchless mechanism, and certainly very easy to repair. It's not every day there's already an O-ring at Home Depot for a piston filler. The main reason Noodlers offers the gaskets for the smaller piston filler is because this simply is not the case. I can't point you to a store to get an affordable O-ring that's widely available. In this case, I'm not offering this O-ring because it is widely available at hardware stores. Hope this information was of use to you, and that if you've seen this video, you're all set for repairing this particular pen and maintaining it yourself without the need for excessive cost for the life of the pen. That's it.